Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to yet another session of Entrepreneur India's Resilience Series. The months-long lockdown has not failed to remind us of our daily weight gains. And that is more of my guilt statement, to be very honest. Negligible movement and easy access to the kitchen only led to thin eating. Even during the unlock phase, when the economy is opening up, people are still hesitant to step inside a gym to break a sweat due to the highly contagious virus outbreak. This is where several players have stepped in to offer a fitness regime to lead a much healthier life while being at home. And this is what we are going to focus on today. I'm Saurav Kumar, editor of Special Projects Entrepreneur India, the moderator for the session. To update our Facebook viewers, the discussion will go on for 30 minutes and followed by taking up questions from the audience. Post your questions through the comment section and do mention if you want a specific panelist to answer it. Let me now introduce our panelists for the day. We have with us today Mr. Amaresh Ojha, founder and CEO of Gympic, and Mr. Manan Chandan, founder Healthify Studio. And we'll soon be joined by Mr. Vaibhav Donkulwar, CEO and founder Better Capital. Thank you for joining us today, Amaresh, Manan. So, you know, while we are still struggling with the virus, with the possible second wave, while we are still debating work from home culture, fitness at home is another buzz. So in brief, you know, if you can tell our viewers, what are you offering and, you know, how does it help? So if I can start with Amaresh.
Cool. So Gympic is a fitness discovery platform which helps people to find different gyms or the fitness studios which are around them and do that. We also have a backend software which is being used by the gyms to manage their end-to-end offering and also make the engagement going with the customers, right? So we have close to 1,000 plus clubs who are using our software to manage their backend and also engage with the with the customers. So during the pandemic, we launched a lot of facilities which really enabled people to work out at home. We integrated with the virtual, we integrated with the virtual tool providers where any gym can enable their members to attend the virtual classes where one trainer at the gym is basically doing the classes and the different members can attend those classes. We saw a good response for that. We also enabled one-on-one classes where somebody who has taken personal training can opt for those services and people are using that. So they are the two verticals that we have launched during the pandemic. Post-pandemic, we also launched the slot booking, which basically enables people to visit to the gym and make sure the gyms are not crowded.
Okay. Manan?
So I've been a part of Healthify Me for a couple of years right now, and within Healthify Me, we kind of realized that there was definitely some value in having some sort of a digital workout solution, since Healthify Me has always stood for nutrition and diet as well. So, I mean, this is something that we thought that we wanted to add as value to our users as well, and Healthify Studio is kind of the brainchild. At that point of time, we've kind of worked as a startup within a startup over here right now, and we've been working very almost tirelessly since the past few months, where we've been trying to innovate on product and also on different types of workout formats as well, where we've kind of built a platform where users can access live workouts with trainers and fitness and with trainers and other coaches who are proficient at their art from across the globe. So, I mean, like, you can be in India and learn yoga perhaps from some yoga trainer who's maybe in Bali or something. And this all works internationally as well. So we've kind of built this thing out as a system and tried to innovate a little bit more on formats of workouts as well, where we've had formats for kids, for senior citizens, and this is something that we've built out and given access to our entire user base on Healthify Me as well, and also it's available as a public website as well. So during the quarantine and during the pandemic, we kind of realized by surveying our user base that, hey, this is something that was a need, and it's something that has always been in our mind, but we've just never prioritized the execution of it, but considering the situation that we were during the pandemic, this is something that we kind of built out really, really rapidly and got into the hands of our users really soon.
All right. Thank you. Vaibhav is there. Hi, Vaibhav. Good to see you again.
Hi.
So, you know, you've heard Amrish, you've heard Manan. So, you know, my question to you would be, when you look at someone like a Gympic or Healthify Studio, maybe, or any other in that space, you know, so where we already had YouTube tutorials, you know, and, you know, guides online, which were there. So what is it that you look, you know, you think is different from, you know, these kind of solutions that are being offered, like customized, which are packaged and you need to pay for it? Why would someone pay for these packages rather than, you know, just looking at a celebrity doing yoga or, you know, yoga instructors available online through YouTube, you know, free of cost maybe?
Yeah, no, great question. So I think, you know, the first of all, I think a very fundamental thing has happened all over the world in the last 9 months, right? Which is that people realized that they could actually work out from home, right? Around the world, more and more people have experienced that they have picked up a resolution to be healthy multiple times of their lives, paid subscriptions, never maintained going to that gym, and did it over again every few years, right? And no. Just because of the lockdown, you were people who were regular in their workouts, as well as people who were trying to get fit and were not being consistent, all of them adopted this and suddenly found out that it works, right? I don't need fancy machinery. A set of dumbbells is actually good enough if I can use videos and some coaching to get my form right and whatnot, right? So I think that is kind of foundation of what we are seeing across the world today, right? And now on top of it, then, you know, the other ingredient that we are seeing across companies, right, which is where your question comes in, which is like, if I have the dumbbells at home, there is somebody in YouTube who's doing the live class, then do I really need something more? And do I really need to pay somebody, right? And that's what I think what we've seen is there is this whole aspect of motivation that comes in, correct? Through our investments in a company like Fitter, we've seen that play out at scale where people are working out from home, but paying for that personal coach because they need that motivation, number one. And number two, they need some level of personalization which says that, hey, you know, what is your goal? And what are you looking to achieve? How much have you tried before? Where have you failed? And now let me tell you how to get this right. Let's try this. Let's see what happens in 2 weeks. Okay, you know, we're still behind. Let me give you another example of how we can try to fix this, right? So I think it's that motivation and personalization, which is what we are paying for. Okay. And I think that is there to stay. And essentially for that motivation and personalization, the TAM just increased 10x because you don't have to go to the gym or see anybody anymore, right? You can do it from home. Which is, I think, a very big inflection point for everyone today in the business
industry. Okay. Manan, coming to you, you know, Vaibhav said that, you know, that personalization is something, you know, rather than me watching a generic video, someone, you know, telling me steps, but someone watching me, online and telling me, is that really the differentiation, or would you say that there is more to it?
So when it came to remote workouts and while we were conceptualizing this, I think there were two broad methods in which you could kind of do it. These are either it's on demand or it's live. And when we are doing it in a live format, there were maybe again two ways to do it as well, whether it's like in a classroom style setup or whether it's like a webinar, or like something like we're doing right now where it's live and like thousands of people can join over here. But at Healthify Studio, we kind of focused on the live side and the classroom side as well, because Healthify has always been a platform which has stood for coaching and what personalized help that we can give. Very, very similar to what Weber mentioned right now. I mean, how do we help users kind of break those plateaus, give them guidance and advice on how it can be more personalized for them, and give them advice based on their goals. So when we broke it down, we kind of realized that the value that a coach adds is maybe on three things. There is, whilst doing a workout, it's demonstration, there is motivation, and there's correction. That kind of helps you out and helps you understand that, okay, how do I do something? Am I doing it correctly? And kind of pushes me to do it more often, or like do those extra reps and sets over here. So that's the way we kind of look to break it down and built out the platform, keeping these pillars in mind. So we took a contrarian approach where we kind of tried to aggregate different types of trainers, different people who are practicing this particular, practicing their workouts over there across the globe, and kind of try to get them all onto one platform, have a unified schedule, and allow users to kind of book classes based on whatever their personal goals are. And during the class, we concentrate on having a more smaller group session vibe where there are lesser number of people, and you kind of get personalized help and correction during the session, where a coach will come and tell you that, hey, it looks like what you're doing is correct. Can you maybe just put in, can you just like correct your angle over here, or like you're going, your ankle placement is not correct while you're doing your squats over there. So this is the kind of personalized help that we've been trying to add over here.
Okay. Thank you, Manan. So, you know, I'll go to Amrish. Amrish was just speaking about what exactly, you know, Manan was saying, that, you know, the posture. As I was mentioning that, you know, if done wrong, you know, an exercise can harm a person rather than help him. So now we're talking about posture. So how much technology can really help, you know, like if I have a trainer when I'm at your gym, wherever, you know, he will just hold me and give me a support and, you know, kind of tell me that, okay, this is wrong. But can't really technology do that?
True. So if you see the broader spectrum of technology companies, which not only in India, but even in abroad, actually. So we have Peloton and Mirror, which are like almost more than $1 billion companies, right? And these companies are completely focused on that, where there's an interface, which is more like a TV or a big mirror, where you are working out and there's a coach who is watching you live and help you do that. Now, two things which I always say, we have two kind of people who understand fitness and people who are novice, who haven't done anything. Right. So people who have done fitness in their journey some time, I mean, have exercised in a gym or have gone to any of the group classes, they know the importance of these things and they have a little confidence that they can do that. But somebody who is starting for the first time, trying to do it only online, for them is a challenge. Right. Because even if the technology that you have, you really can't see that person in a 360 degree view. Right. So because it depends on the kind of camera and the capabilities you have on top of that. So the current setup that we have and all the tools that I have seen through, they are very limited. Right. So even if you are doing, suppose, squats, I can see you from the front view, but I really don't know how is your back movement, the kind of posture that you have for the back. Right. So is this not going to help the people who are starting for the first time their fitness journey? And that's where you would have seen the trend, and which is like when the lockdown started for the first time, many people opted for these virtual group classes or all the virtual classes. But the people who started for the first time, they slowly dropped out. I mean, you were mentioning your thing, like it's as good as if you have not studied anything on a subject, and I put you in a place where there are 1,000 books on that, and now it's up to you. You pick up something and do, right? But if you have understanding of that subject, you know what to pick up and which to start with, right? And so that's the difference. So for the people who understand fitness, is good to go. They can interact with the trainer. They know what to do. They can ask him, okay, put few more reps for me. But for somebody who is novice, who has no clue what to do, for them is a bigger challenge.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So does that actually shrink the pie, actually, that, you know, of people who want to do something about fitness, staying at home or otherwise also? So does that decrease the, you know, shrink the pie for people like you or anyone who's offering, solutions from home?
It does. It does. Definitely it does. For the people who are who have not really worked out. So, and this is what we have seen with our thing. When a lot of gyms, they launched their virtual classes for their memberships, we didn't have much buyers who were looking for those kind of solutions. I mean, a few people, they bought it, but they could not continue. But what we have seen, people who have been exercising regularly, they are very regular for these group classes. I mean, they enjoy that. They find a way to do that. So I always say that, and this is something which I talk in different forums. I think fitness is more about how you make it a habit, right? So once it has become a habit for you, you will find ways to exercise, right? Mm-hmm. If not this one, probably you'll find something else to do that. But for the people who haven't crossed that journey, who are still in that phase where they have to make it as a habit, they struggle. And for them, only virtual is not going to be a solution. Either you look for a hybrid model or you need a physical interaction where somebody is watching them personally, he's motivating them personally. So that helps.
Yeah, so I think it works for people who actually at least cross that threshold of
exactly
motivation or something. So Vaibhav, I'll come to you now. You know, you just heard Amdesh, you heard Manan, that you know how. So do you think it is sustainable, or it's just a quick fix that has, you know, a lot of these solutions came during the pandemic? You know, so is it like, okay, we are riding the wave right now till the time, and then, you know, you go back to maybe completely normal scenario of hitting a gym or going to a pool or a park or a stadium? Or is it going to be once, you know, you get into this habit that, okay, I may go to the gym one day, but maybe I can do it at home maybe the other day, because it obviously saves me the time to go to the gym, wait for my turn for the treadmill to get free or something like that. How do you see it?
Yeah, no, great question, right? And I think the pre and post pandemic discussion is happening in every segment around the world today, right? So look, I think like Amrish mentioned, Peloton and Mirror have been around for a while, right? And the reason for their success is that there was a fairly decent demand for working from home for the reasons around saving time, schedules and whatnot, right? So I think we already knew that was there. But again, like Amrish mentioned, I think people who adopted that were also people who were working out and were seeking that, okay, I'm not getting enough time, so let me try this, right? Now, this is the first time, like I mentioned, that a larger percentage of fitness seeking population, the ones who have been working out, ones who had just started, and ones who were like, okay, now that I have free time, maybe I should pick up on that fitness, right? So all of them suddenly got exposed to the possibility of fitness at home, right? So I think net-net, we will be positive, number one. Number two, I think we will end up seeing kind of a blended approach, because I think the fun of working out with your friends in a physical space is never going to go away, correct? So I think that's going to stay. But if I were making to my gym 3 days a week, I will continue to make it 3 days a week there, but I'll do the rest 2 days or 3 days from home, right? Because now I know that's possible. So I think that will happen to people who are already working out. And then there is a new segment of people who just discovered that, okay, within my schedule now, actually I can start to remain fit by doing the online classes, right? So from that perspective, I think it's going to be a net positive for fitness from home. It's not going to be kind of a temporary thing that just vanishes once everything opens up, because I think our time constraint remains the same pre and post pandemic.
Right.
So that's how I look at it.
Yeah. And I also think the thing that you mentioned about, you know, socializing, which Amrish was telling me, that it, you know, going to a gym is not only about, you know, you working out, but it's about the camaraderie there that you find, right, Amrish? That's what you
said. Absolutely. So a lot of time, what happens, even if there's a goal that we tell, like, okay, I'm joining this gym because I have a goal to lose, suppose, 5 kgs or 2 kgs, right? But a lot of time you also have these intrinsic goals, what we call. So what happens to that? I'll tell you. So I go to gym because I get to talk to people apart from my work and home. So this is more like a socializing place for me where I meet new people. There are a lot of people, they go there because they get to try different kind of workouts or different exercises, right? Some people go because that gym has a restaurant which serves healthy food, right? So you have different motivations and we really can't go away with that, right? And as Vaibhav said correctly, it's not going to be only virtual or only gyms. See, now what happened, initially people were reluctant to try the virtual classes because they're like, I don't know how it's going to happen. But after this pandemic, they were forced to try that. And when they tried, they're like, okay, it's okay. I can do that. It's working for me. So this is going to be a hybrid model where a few days you go to the gym, but few days where you are running out of time or you are not in a mood to go to the gym, then you're like, okay, I'll log in from home and I'll do my workout.
Okay. Manan, I'll come to, you know, we just heard Vaibhav and Amrish on, being a hybrid model. Your solution came during the pandemic. So was it, what was your idea? So was it a top up on, you know, people doing exercise, gymming and everything? Or was it like, let's make it a habit for everyone to be at home and do the workout?
So HealthFMU is always a digital first platform. And to be honest, like building something like HealthFMU Studio is always on our backlog at any given point of time. We've always wanted to kind of have this thing as a capability, but we were just never able to prioritize it. But during the pandemic, obviously the situation changed and we realized, hey, this is something that users are demanding. And this is something that we also wanted to give into their hands. And exactly like how Vaibhav and Amrish mentioned that, yes, I mean, like, we also completely imagine it that after the pandemic, this will be a hybrid approach where people will be using this. I think what's happened is that more and more people have tried it out and more people have realized that it's not just convenient, it's also effective. Like you also can lose weight, you can achieve your fitness goals by doing workouts at home as well. And a lot of the public or a lot of the audience of people who kind of dabble in fitness rather than pursue it very, very actively, it kind of is a very effective way for them to like just try out different things. And most of the time you actually see that when people take a membership of like a gym or something, they would want to try different formats and eventually they would realize, hey, this is a good trainer or this is a good format that works for me. So we kind of try to give them that diversity and allow them to pick what works for them. And eventually the hope is that they will do it more often. And like you said, we just want to build a habit over here. So that's something that we're definitely driving towards. And we definitely have a lot of faith and trust in the platform. And we're hoping to integrate it a lot more deeper going forward.
Okay. So, Manan, staying with me, too, when building out such a platform, you know, if I have to do it today, you know, I think of doing. So what were the lessons like? What are your learnings that you would want to tell me that these were the things have to be kept in mind while building such a product?
Sure. So I think one of the most, something that was very, very valuable to us specifically during this point was being closely in touch with our users and understanding exactly what is it that they have in mind. The reason I say this specifically is that when the pandemic was just about to begin and when the lockdown was announced in India, it was actually a very anxious time for most people, right? Many people didn't know that how their lives and livelihoods would be. And this was maybe at some point of time, they've taken some investment in their health and they don't know whether it's something that they'll be able to continue or what they want to do over here. So having those conversations with them, and we've always been advocates of the fact that you can do workouts at home. I mean, a lot of time it's just about doing something rather than not doing anything over here. So we've definitely pushed people a lot more and kind of understood that, hey, this is something that you are interested in trying out and how can we help you enable it? So you could be maybe a 40-year-old housewife who wants to juggle your housework along with a workout over there. And how is it that, how can we help you do that? So if people go ahead and say that, hey, the only time I get to do the workout is maybe early in the morning over here, and I unfortunately have only 30 minutes of workout before I need to plug my kids into their Zoom classes over here as well. So that's what we tried to build towards. And how do we have enough workout formats and classes available for longer durations, shorter durations, for beginners, for people who are advanced, who are novices, people who just want to have fun. So, I mean, we have like dance voice workouts as well. So they actually enjoy themselves while they're doing it. But that obviously is the content layer of building this entire product out? I mean, like when we obviously did it, we also realized that, hey, there is an opportunity right now and it makes sense to kind of execute on this really, really fast. So we deliberately took a decision at that point of time to build on top of readily available frameworks like Zoom and have video tech that was already scalable, something that was already just off the shelf, where we didn't want to invest in building something very, very specifically. And because at the end of the day, people are going to come back for the fact that they had a good workout session. They're not going to come back for the fact that ye aapka video quality sabse sahi tha. So that is the reason why we decided that we'll kind of take more leaner, more agile decisions in a way that we can get the product into the hands of our users faster and then iterate and understand better in terms of what is it that they want and how do we just keep the content fresh at all points of time.
So what kind of content is getting consumed? I mean, what kind of workouts are people opting for? Zumba, aerobics, or what are people most excited about?
So dance has always been a very, very popular format. I mean, like people love engaging in some sort of fun activity while they're doing it as well. We've also tried, we obviously gave the team a full hand over here and people went ahead and tried all sorts of different formats. So we tried Tai Chi, we tried indoor walking, all sorts of stuff over here. And there have been people who've been adopting all of these things over here. And something that is also popular is typically like bodyweight workouts, because most people did not have access to gyms and weight equipment. So, I mean, like lots of times we saw people trying out fun things during their classes where they would figure out the most obscure things in their houses to act as weights, right? You'd get people with suitcases trying to lift that up and like, okay, fine, this is my weight today. Or like, you know, you're those 20 liter water cans that they're trying to pick up over here. Okay, fine, this is something that I'm trying out over here. So in a way, it's been fun and that's kind of helped build the community angle around things as well. So usually at the end of a class, people are really happy to kind of pose for like that sweaty selfie at the end of the day, where you kind of have this thing of a Zoom screenshot that has been broadcasted. And basically it's also been good that it's been amplified on social media as well, because many people have started doing these workouts and they post about the fact that, hey, I'm doing this workout over here, which piques the curiosity of other people who want to try something out. So it's kind of created a good virtuous cycle, I would say.
Okay. Amrish, what has been your observation?
I think Maran said it correctly. People were trying different forms, different exercises, because it was a forced adoption, right? People didn't have choices and they were like all locked indoor, right? So people were trying different things. We saw a lot of people opting for Zumba. People were doing, strength and conditioning and a lot of other type of workouts. So I think it has worked. People, it gave them a good flavor of different exercises. I would say it was more about creating awareness of different kind of workouts and the forms which exist. And many people have tried it. So I think post lockdown, if people like a particular form, they might continue with that exercise, right? And this is what we have seen, like somebody who has been experimenting for 2-3 weeks and now has become regular in some form of exercises.
Okay. You know, before I go to the next question, I'll request our audience to keep their questions coming in case they have. We'll take them up shortly in another 5 minutes maybe. So wherever I'll come to, you know, listening to Manan and Amrish, and I was speaking to Manan earlier also, he said that there are trainers from, you know, Indonesia, Bali, who can train you. And it seems like like the MOOC moment for it, what happened to education. You know, I could sit here and learn from a professor from MIT or, you know, Harvard sitting right at my home. So is that a good sign for this sector, you know, the good opportunity which it brings in with it?
Yeah, I absolutely think so, right? Because I think the digitization of fitness is actually a massive thing, right? Because it creates opportunities for tech, for people, for coaches, for platforms, for everything, right? I mean, if you just look at awareness of fitness in 2020 versus so far, I'm sure we'll kind of see a hockey stick kind of a curve. Because it suddenly became top of mind for because of what is not talked about enough, which is just more time. I think for all the bad that the pandemic stands for, it actually has given us all more time than ever before, right? And I think fitness has been a beneficiary of that time. And I think that's a net good for the world, because we all need to be far fitter than we are, right? So I think in general, I think it is a net positive across the board. And I think what it does to fitness entrepreneurs or fitness professionals all over the world is incredible, I think, right? Because they were not able to earn as much as I believe they will with the, you know, physical digital hybrid that we will see going forward, right? And so I think just for fitness coaches, let's just say, right, I think globally it's just going to be far better of a future than it has been so far, right? Because we've also proved, like Manan said, I think like we've also proved that it's not just about tech, it's the experience, right? And the experience will not happen without the personalization and the coaching. So I think it's net very, very positive across the board. And I'm sure across India as well, we'll see a number of different models being created that will kind of just increase the size of the pie for everyone.
Okay. So staying with you, wherever you have invested in Fitter, and we have people like Jimpik and Healthify Studio, and we have others as well. So if you have to tell them that, okay, here's another two, three things that if you do, I think it will have more return for not only the investor, but for the people who are using it. And now that we're talking about, you know, because we need unit economics has become very important now. So you need to earn money. You need to get the customers to pay. So if you have those, if you can tell me two, three things that in your experience you have seen that entrepreneurs have done, but have lacked this. And if had that been there, it would have been better. Is there anything, if any?
Look, I think all of them are far smarter than me and they're doing all the right things.
Definitely.
Right? But I think if I were to zoom out and say that, look, what are we learning across companies, right? How do we continue to scale in fitness in general? So I think the fundamental thing in fitness has been very easy and has been known for the longest time, which is outcomes, right? So every fitness company that delivers outcomes will continue to succeed. And they have just been the beneficiary of the largest inflection point that fitness has ever seen, correct? So I think we continue to advise our companies and founders in the fitness segment that everything that you do, if that does not increase the outcomes that your customers are seeing, then what you are doing is probably not going to dramatically improve your valuation or your value or the perceived value in the eyes of the users, right? Because once you have outcomes, you have retention. Once you have retention, you have better LTV. And once you have better LTV, you just look like a, you know, phenomenal business in, you know, across a, you know, whichever way you slice and dice it, right? So I think outcomes is everything. And the funny thing is, it's actually, it's good that there is one simple thing that actually defines what you need to build towards, because not every industry, you know, has that, right? They always have to seek, hey, you know, what's going to be that one thing, right? But I think in fitness, it's just outcomes, right? If I have 100,000 users and more of them every day feel that they are closing towards their outcomes, then it's just going to be a better business.
Okay. All right. You know, you talked about users, so I'll come to Amrish and Manan now. And you know, we have seen this and we just talked about that, you know, people would take up gym subscriptions and hardly turn up. So how has been the experience with this online thing? Have people actually paid money, you know, kind of subscribed, and is the attendance better, you know, when it comes to, you know, actually going to a gym rather than doing, you know, it online?
See, this is what is typically a pattern for people who buys a membership, either online or offline. I mean, we have more data on the offline side. So for the first couple of weeks, they are very regular. They will try to come at least 3-4 days a week. Within a month, it comes down to like twice a week. And after that, they drop off. So 80% people have the similar life cycle. And they come back once there's a renewal pending, or they'll renew in some other gym or a fitness center. We see a similar pattern here also, because what happens, I think it's again on the habit side, like what basically they are looking for. Or and see, this is something that we all need to realize. I mean, the industry that we operate, especially in a country like India, people still don't see fitness as a need. I mean, it's more like something good to have, and they want to fit it in the free time what they have, rather than making time for it actually, and which is very unfortunate. And we hope that after this pandemic, things will change and people will start taking fitness more seriously, because there were a lot of people, they were calling me in the pandemic, like how to increase my immunity, what workout I can do quickly so that it boosts. But there's no shortcut. I mean, you need to keep doing every day so that you have a healthy body. And I hope after this fear of pandemic, people will realize that they need to work out regularly, and you have to make time for it.
Mm. Now, you make a very valid point here. I think, Amrish, that you know, it goes for, like, I can draw corollary from, you know, a financial planning perspective, which I used to write earlier, that you know, you first need to save and then you need to, you know, spend. And that is how you build a corpus for yourself. So I believe you're correct that, you know, you need to find time for your workout every day, and then rather, you know, plan your day accordingly and not say that if I'll have time, I'll go and work out. That's a very valid point, I believe. Yeah, Manan, so what has been your experience in terms of, you know, dropouts or people being regular with the sessions and all? Or is it same like, you know, I have a subscription with Gold?
Actually, so in our case, we've actually seen really good participation. So, I mean, it's really been, so fortunately, we can explain it in maybe two ways. One is that we always had our premium users who were always in touch with a coach in a digital fashion. So they always had that thought in their head that Healthify Me is a digital platform, and now this is an added-on service that we have, and you always have that coach who's kind of telling you that, hey, make sure you join this workout today. And the other benefit of kind of building on top of a tech layer is that we actually get to remind users that, hey, it's time to work out over here, and we have access to their entire social graph as well. So I mean, you actually know that if a user likes this particular workout and other people also tend to like this workout, then there are lots of interesting things that you can do around recommending different types of workouts and letting them know what is it that keeps it fresh for them. So having access to kind of the full stack where users log their meals on Healthify Me as well, they can understand how many calories they've consumed, and we can also recommend how much, what workout you can do to burn those calories as well. So it helps us kind of build an entire integrated approach. So that is what we're kind of going towards. Obviously, I mean, like when people go to, I mean, this is not going to stop people going into physical spaces. I mean, like we don't even imagine that that's ever going to stop over here. But then we just feel that the entire experience is something that we can build to be a lot more integrated, tighter coupled, especially with people eventually moving, buying more and more wearables and all those devices as well. So all that, the entire quantified self actually comes out into the fore, and we'll definitely be watching the space a lot more closely.
So are you going to use the technology leverage and your reach to pester everyone to take up the cliched New Year resolution of hitting the gym every morning? Is that something you're going to do?
So fortunately, I mean, like, this magically happens every January by itself only. So I mean, like, whenever we don't need to notify users. I mean, that's usually this whole across users, they usually kind of wake up on 1st of January with this in mind. So I mean, we obviously want to enable them as much as possible, but definitely a good time to be in health and fitness in January for sure.
All right. So gentlemen, we have a four, five minutes more to go. So we'll take some questions that we have gotten on Facebook. So Ankita wants to know, and I think Amrish, I will toss this one to you, that what's the difference between a functional gym and a fixed press gym? I have no idea what is this.
Even I don't know that. Never heard of it. Okay. Functional gyms, obviously, I know where you have a lot of workout that you do without the equipment. It's more on the body weight. Hmm. I mean, what you see at the Zumba studios or mixed martial arts and those kind of things. But the other one, I'm not really aware of. Never heard of
it. We'll let this pass. I'm not sure. Okay. So there's another question that I used to go to gym, but now I don't have enough place at my home to work out. How do you think fitness startups will address this problem, given that a lot of Indians stay in smaller house, 1 BHK or something? So Manan, I think you were explaining something around this to me. So if you can again, help.
Yeah, I mean, like that is usually has been a bit of a challenge over there, where people have been, obviously the intent to work out is there, but usually they are constricted by how much space that they have. And usually during workouts, you also require a little, I mean, most people actually like some privacy. You don't want people constantly like peeping into your screen and kind of seeing what all is happening over there. So how we can look to solve it is, again, something that we are also don't correctly have the answer on it yet, and how we can kind of make it a lot more easier. But what we've tried to and what we've thought of doing at least is kind of have overlaid layers on top of the screen to kind of guide users and help them understand what is the best sort of positioning that they can have during a workout, so that their coach is actually able to see them correctly and help correct them and understand what is it that they are doing correctly or incorrectly.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. So there's another question which I think it will be more of a clarification for you to give, is that Shipra says most online workout sessions offered by fitness startups are pre-recorded. Don't you think live interactive classes would be more engaging for users? So I believe there are already live classes. If you can just enlighten the audience, please, Amrish.
Okay, so two things. Actually, I think it also depends on the limitations that we have now. A lot of centers are launching the live classes, but depending on the internet speed or the connectivity available, people are not able to see that. I mean, so even if there's a class which is happening live, not everybody can stream at the same rate, right? So that's the challenge that you have with the live classes. And for that, sometimes it becomes very painful for them, because the time you get the connection back, the trainer has moved to some other sequence which you could not finish. The good thing with the pre-recorded workouts, and that's where many of the startups have these classes pre-recorded and they telecast it at a fixed time, is you avoid this thing, because these videos are loaded locally on the laptop or the browser that you have, and it's which is being played. So I think that's the thing. And there are a lot of offerings where people can go for the live classes if you have good connectivity and internet.
Okay. So, Vaibhav, I'll come to you. For the previous question on having limited space in our houses, obviously that's a truth for most of the households, especially in the metros, where we apartment dwelling people, rather than, tier three, tier four, where you have big houses usually. So do you think there needs to be some other kind of solutions for maybe people who are living in smaller houses, or people who have their own, I won't call it bungalows, but their own houses, where typically in a small town that we see? Do you think that there needs to be a change in the offering from the players?
I'm not so sure, honestly, because I think, like Manan mentioned, I'm not sure how a provider could potentially solve the space constraint issue, right? I think what we will see is users kind of working around their constraints, whether, apartment has a community hall that they can end up using. There are a lot of people who actually do yoga classes in the open, in a garden, and things like that as well, right? So I think it'll be very hard for a provider to design around that. I mean, there's nothing I can think of right now, but I think users will figure out solutions, just because, again, if we go back to why are they doing that? They're doing that because, look, they don't have time, or their intent is there. So once that is there, I think they will end up figuring out solutions around it. There's very little that a provider could potentially help to solve that problem.
Okay. Yeah, I think that would really differ. I mean, from space to space. So, we have another question from Siddharth Sharma. Siddharth, are you there online? So, you can ask your question. Siddharth. Okay, I'll ask the question on his behalf. I think to an extent we have kind of answered this, but still. Siddharth, if you can unmute yourself and ask the question.
Yeah,
no problem. So I think what he wants to is for newbies into exercise, it's tough to understand the coaches which shares the pre-recorded video. How can we change that? Obviously, with pre-recorded videos, I mean, if something is recorded, obviously, you cannot question them. But anything, Manan, Amrish, you would want to add?
So I think, as I told you earlier, the virtual classes are definitely not going to replace the one-on-one experience that you have. And the kind of confidence you get when somebody is watching you personally is very high when a technology or a tool you are following, right? That's definitely not going to go away. And for the newbies, that's a challenge. And what Manan told earlier, like a lot of time, the offerings they try to personalize, where there's something which is being predefined for you, which you can follow in a sequence rather than a broadcasted video.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So we have run out of time, but we have one question which resonates with me as well. So I will definitely ask this question before I let you gentlemen go. And I will ask this question to Vaibhav, maybe. Vaibhav, how do I drag myself out to make myself, you know, do workout? You know, I've thought about it. You know, Amrish was telling me, if nothing else, you just climb up the stairs of your building. That would be enough. Manan has promised that he'll get me he will get me in touch with someone from Bali who does a 5 a.m. morning yoga class or something, that I'll get fit. But to your question, how do you drag out? If I'm sure that you've been in this habit, but for a newbie, what do they do? I think that will just froze. So Amrish, if I can toss this question to you, you know, how do we get people to, you know, how can I drag myself out? What is that mentality? What do I need to think? What do I need to tell myself?
I think Vaibhav is online.
Yeah, Vaibhav is online. Yeah, Vaibhav, if you heard my question. Still think there's some problem. So Amrish, if you can answer that. Yeah.
Sure. And this is something which I talk in different forums and which is very relevant to all of us. I think we need to realize the importance of a healthy body. If you don't have that, it's a bigger problem. I mean, see, healthy mind is obviously part of it, but you can have only when you have a healthy body. And for that, you need to exercise. Then there's no other way. So I think we need to keep reminding ourselves that a physical workout is needed for us. And this is something, it's as good as when you wake up in the morning and you plan your breakfast, you need to plan your workout. And the moment we realize this need, the need of your physical health, I think things should be fine. The only problem is we never take it seriously. So this mindset has to change. And that will happen only when you keep reminding yourself the importance of this. I mean, we look up to a lot of people like, okay, these people have this kind of body structure, but we are not ready to put effort to achieve that. It's like, okay, I'm okay with whatever I have. I talk to a lot of people, they're like, I'm fine with my body. Even if you are not healthy, it's not about fat or slim or whatever, but do you feel healthy? I mean, and this is something when you talk to people who have been working out, they'll say one thing like being fit is very addictive, right? If you are fit, you feel that the kind of feeling you get is very different. I mean, nothing can buy that, right? And people have to get used to that. I mean, they should have that craving, and then only probably you will not have to drag out. Probably you will run to the gym and do your workout.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Vaibhav, we have run out of time, but there is one question that I would still want to know from you, especially, is that, you know, like insurance, what I feel from all this is that still selling a product like Fitter or a Gympic or a Healthy Studio is still a push product. It's not a pull product. Seems like so. So is there anything that could be done to change this?
No, I think you're absolutely right. It is still in that category where there is some amount of pull, but for the rest of it, I think it's the determination that is deeply lacking, right? And I think as I think Amrish probably articulated it best, unless we imagine fitness as a daily habit, it's going to not change. Now, having said that, I think world over, we are seeing an upswing in that education, right? So whether it's Fitter or Gympic or Healthify Me, all of them are going to only get better. All of them are only going to get more people seeking them out and building that habit and things like that. So so I think it's a hard problem, but it is a problem that is starting to solve itself slowly. And I think if you just look at the marathons that happen in India today, 10 years ago, nobody would have imagined that people will pay to run in India. People would have never imagined that people would take a flight ticket from Delhi to Mumbai to run the Mumbai Marathon, correct? So I think we are, all the trends are positive. I think the pandemic has accelerated some of it. So I think it's only good days ahead for all of us.
All right. So thank you, everyone. You know, we've run out of time, so we'll have to close it here. But it was really enlightening for me and for our viewers as well to understand that what exactly are the offerings. We hear about, you know, fitness, online fitness solutions, but to hear firsthand that how it can help and what are the offerings was really good for me. And I hope that I myself feel motivated to do things that I've been trying to do for a long, long time, but have not been able to do that. That's again my goal statement. So thank you, gentlemen, for being here today. And thank you to our audience also. We'll see you again next week, same time. And hope to see you guys again. Thank you.
Thank you, Saurabh. Thank you. Thank you, Amrish. Thanks, everyone. Thank you. Bye. Thank you. Have a nice day.
Thanks, Saurabh. See you guys. Bye.